yeah, so somehow I didn't really manage to get just one thing to show to you. So you see always the next presentation paper, but it doesn't really matter. I think, it's easier to do it. And you can also see when I run out of time, which I'm already trying to do. So what am I here to talk to you about? It's about Semantic Media Wiki. And telling you about what the current status and what was new in the new version 3.2, which was released this year, which was a major release. And let's start. So again, current status will be covered, then Semantic Media Wiki 3.2 and how you can contribute. And the current status, it's a bit of a tradition now. You can see that since the past SMWCon in Paris, we have seen a total of 8 releases. Last year in Paris, I presented things about the 3.1 major release. And since then, we had 6 bug fix releases to it. And also then in September this year, the new 3.0 release, and I've done this specially for you. Actually, I wanted to do it earlier, but this last weekend, I've done the first bug fix release for it. And so let's see what happens. You know how popular it is. It's still, on a fairly nice level. So there's a lot of interest, a lot of installs and so on, a lot of movement. So it's looks quite nice. And so, that's what it looks like. And what is, let's say, different to last year, we have changed the release policy a bit. So in future, we will see a bit more major releases, which means if we drop support for one version of MediaWiki, we will bump for a major release. And also if we require update PHP to be run, and also if there are breaking changes to functionality, syntax, and things alike. These reasons may occur in isolated, but it might be also a melange of two reasons or so. But let's say just one reason also justifies doing next major bump, which means if you pin your installation to a specific major version, you won't be surprised by, let's say, pulling in a new updated version for this series and have to run, let's say, update PHP or, let's say, full data rebuild, things like this. Yeah. In the past, you know, also, let's say, a minor release was triggering this, but I think it's better now. Yeah. And I quite like this. Yeah. If you want to look at the details of this policy, I've uploaded my presentation. It's on the wiki, and just follow this link or on the repository. You can also see the details. So it's easy accessible. And then now let's move forward to the new release, which was done early September, even earlier than the major long-term release of MediaWiki 135, which was, let's say, important to me. So that if you want to move forward with your software, you could do it all at once, rather than doing a major release for MediaWiki, and then a month later you have a new major release of Semantic MediaWiki, and so on and so forth. So I think this was good to do. So what was there about this release? This time we haven't seen so many new features. Actually, the past two releases, let's say release 3.0 was, brought a lot of new features and changes. And the last 3.1 version also brought a lot of features and enhanced features and so on, brought, let's say, really cool new stuff. And this one was a bit, I would say, to consolidate things, and it was more focusing on the administration of a software set in the background. So user-facing changes weren't that, let's say, aren't that visible in this release, and which is okay, because I think we already have a pretty good bunch of, or let's say, convolute of features here, and you can do a lot of things. So let's say settling down a bit and let's say look at other things is was a good thing. Nah? And yeah, and this was created basically within a year, and we had about let's say 500 end commits by 18 contributors, which is a bit similar to the last release. I think last time we had 19 contributors and 700 and something commits. Admittedly, most of that action happened till, let's say, the end of May. So between May, actually, I could have released it in June, and we wouldn't have been have had a, let's say, very different release. But yeah. And what was there to say about compatibility? Now the compatibility is the long-term release 131 to MediaWiki long-term 135. So if you are hopping from one long-term release of MediaWiki to the next one, this is the version you need to migrate to, or to do the migration without, let's say, a lot of fuss. Nah? So it should be fairly good. And the minimum requirement for PHP was raised to 7.1, and we already introduced support for 7.4. 7.1, for this reason, if you're using a Debian 9, this is, I think it's, or still, no, if you're on a Debian 9, yeah, really, that's, I think it has 7.1 as a PHP version, so you can, you don't really have to upgrade at the same time the operating system. That's like this, I think, no? And when it comes to support of relational and RDF and Elasticsearch, there weren't any changes. So this is just to give you a glimpse on what this was about. And let's go to the enhancements. And yeah, I let's say structured it a bit to let's say enhancement for users. I think this is more interesting for a lot of users here now in on the SMWCon than the enhancements probably for administrators. But yeah, since the 3.1 release, you are able to use the schema namespace and add let's say schemas in JSON format, and now the let's say the display was improved, meaning that you now have a little search field and such, so you can enter if it's a very large schema, you know, you can now search for keywords or let's say strings within this page and go directly to it. You can, as you can see, it's a bit small. You can, let's say, collapse and expand nodes in within the JSON representation of a schema. And and we still have all these schemas which were introduced in the previous release, which are, let's say, displayed now like this. And I think it's a nice improvement. Yeah? And you can also copy and paste it. It's really, really cool. Yeah? And also, if you are using a profile schema for a property, for example, if you have some constraints or let's say allowed values and so on, you can now see, there's a new tab which now gives you a representation of this let's say constraints or additional characteristics of that property, yeah, which is quite nice to have a look, to have a, let's say, easier view of these things. And then, when it comes to features for users too, you can now see if you're on a property page, you can now filter by things, you can search within the filter. It was possible before, but it was not really visible what features you have, so you had to go to the SMW to the web SemanticMediaWiki.org to have a look, what can I do? Now we have a new help balloon which details what you can do in the filter, but it's quite nice. And also another improvement for users was if you have a record and add it to a page, now you have a little sign and you can click on it and you get a tooltip, which then details you, let's say, the properties consisting of this, making up this record and with the data added to it, which is probably quite nice. And sometimes people weren't sure, is this a namespace now, let's say, enabled for annotations? Yeah, it's a warning if it's not the case. And also another feature, which is, let's say, an admin and user feature, is that now the software provides predefined property groups. You know, in one of the earlier versions, I think it was the recent 3.0 release, you were able to do some property grouping, which allows to enhance the view or to structure the view on the special browse page. So now, let's say, for most users who don't really want to do the effort, there's, let's say, you can import predefined property groups and they are arranged like this. Well, if you do something locally, this has always precedence to it. So no worries if you have a group and then you get a property group for a similar thing, they won't interfere. And what actually, that it's the only breaking change really for users in this release was that the representation, how the schema structures changed a bit. Yeah? So if you actually use the property group schema for before, then you will have to migrate to the new syntax. Yeah? And you will see it doesn't really work. And then if you look at the page, okay, I have to do something there. But infos on that are documented already on the wiki. That's actually one of the things I really did in the beginning. And the next thing is we have new features for this info parser function, which provides some tooltips and so on. Now you can add a theme to it to adapt a bit your look and feel on the wiki. So here you can see there are two different themes shown. Also, you can see in the first one, it's a bit, you know, the image is not really wide enough for the tooltip, so you can even set a width for it. It's quite nice. No? And another little improvement is, you know, all these parameters to the ask parser function were, let's say, just one string without a blank within it, and except for named args. So now you can also in one row write named args and would work. And another thing we have here is a new entity issue panel, which shows you if you added some data to a wiki, it not just tells you on the wiki page itself, but there's a little let's say sign on the top right of the screen, and then you can click on it and it tells you what are the issues with that annotation, for example. So it's a more visible, let's say, presentation of errors and so on. Yeah? But this was yeah, mostly things. Now we actually go to things which were important for users and admins, or, you know, if you added a schema which, let's say, has an error, it tells you that the structure is not really up to date or has an issue, and it also tells you what issue is there on the schema page. So in my case, I added to this a slide is there was a syntax error. This is what you will be getting if you don't migrate to the new representation of a schema, the new structure, and then you know, okay, I have to work with that, and that's it's especially on the schema page, sometimes you're not really aware, is there some issue or not? And I think it's pretty good to see we have an issue here and have to look at what we added to the page to define the schema. And we have a new user group, which is SMW Editor, and it allows you to new, let's say, permissions we also got. So we have new permissions which allow you to more fine-grained control which user group should see which, let's say, interface information, and yeah, you can have a look at this, and yeah. And yeah, this time we had more features for admins actually to see, is there an issue with my installation, so on. Now, let's say Semantic Media Wiki checks a lot of things. You can see a lot of this here. There's even more. Again, download or look at the presentation I uploaded to the wiki, and you can click on the setup check, and then you are automatically shown back to the page on the documentation, and yeah, so you can have a look of what it's all about. And then another nice feature, which is for people who want to do farming and so on, you have configuration preloading, meaning that with an Able Semantics function, you can actually add, let's say, paths to files, and files which contain configuration which is, let's say, valid for example, for all of your wikis, of your group of wikis, and then on top you can have in local settings, let's say, individual configuration for this very instance, for example, which is quite nice. Yeah. Also, you get maintenance alerts. So if you could look at the SM Semantic Media Wiki special page, you can see, I have to look, I have many outdated entities, let's clear the database because it's just an unnecessary burden, and also table optimization and so on. And there's also a special page which just details these tasks which should be done and so on. And yeah, and the last major thing is we got a new maintenance script which imports schemas and vocabulary once they are put into some place in the on the server. Same thing now, this dispose outdated entity script is a shorthand of scripts you were able to run before. And that's, that's interesting for admins too. And then in the end, you can see it on the right-hand side of this slide, the output on the shell was, let's say, modernized. You can see better what's going on and what's done, what time it takes and so on. So it's quite nice if you are doing this. Yeah? And in the end, all of this can be seen in the release notes. Hold your horses here. I'm planning to actually add this, all of this, to the release notes, which were a bit ascetic, hopefully this afternoon. So let's say starting from tomorrow, you can see all of this also, what I've just walked you through a bit. And yeah. And then again, that's a revaccination in the end. How can you contribute? There's nothing really changed in general. You can create feature requests. You can file bug reports. You can contribute with code and tests and testing and so on. And you can actually become a tester if you would like to. And okay, yeah. Here I must say one thing is that the main developer is a bit inactive at the moment, and I'm not sure when he will return or if he will return. That meaning, if you create a feature request, you most likely will have to organize somebody who is doing it then. If it's about bugs and so on, I think, let's say, fatals are covered. But let's say if you find a bug and feel up for the job and fixing it, then let's say, pull requests are welcome, and then we can move it into the code base once they are okay. Also, with testing and so on, improving the code quality and so on is also important. So if you feel you are able to do it, then you have to do it, because in the future, the community needs to be more involved here than in the past. So let's say we were in a very privileged situation that we had actually a full service programming here for, let's say, for free. And I'm not sure if that will continue in the future. So we have to think about things here. Yeah? And other ways, you can add documentation and so on, enhanced translations, answer questions on the mailing list and so on. You know, we all have a lot of time to things to do and so on, but still perhaps if everybody adds 15 minutes every week for questions which arise on the mailing list and so on, we can all move forward. And what you can do is like Richard and Bernhard is now doing, organizing a cool event like this one, and this is really appreciated, and I really love it. Yeah. And in the end, this was a very quick walkthrough, and time for me to say thank you. And so I'm within my time. So cool.
Thank you very much, Carsten. Are there any questions? You don't have to type. You can also ask to share your audio and video, and you can ask the question here if you want.
Yeah. Should I remove my view now?
Oh, yes, maybe.
Yeah. Okay.
Any questions?
Okay. It's nice. Yeah.
If there is no other question, I would have one. Are there, as the MediaWiki Foundation has announced to move to GitLab, I mean, Semantic MediaWiki is already hosted at GitHub, which in my view is much better than where the MediaWiki things are hosted. Are there plans from your side to move from GitHub to GitLab just to be on the same platform? Did you think about this?
No, I actually don't really see a reason to do this for us. Yeah. One thing is that GitLab, I don't really like the interface there. Perhaps that's a matter of getting used to it, so that's not really an issue. Also, I think participating is as easy on GitHub than on GitLab. In the past, it was, let's say, a bit different. You know, MediaWiki here and Semantic MediaWiki there, it sort of worked, but I think, participating with MediaWiki is easier now once we are on GitLab. But moving to GitLab, I personally don't think so. Let's say if developers think it should be done, then it should be done somehow. But I won't probably be involved here. So I don't think it will happen. Let's put it like this.
Okay. Another question was but I think it's already answered. Can SMW be installed on any MediaWiki server? Jeroen says yes. So,
it means any MediaWiki server means, let's say any server who can run MediaWiki. Yeah.
Yes. I mean, you have to know Semantic MediaWiki is a very clean extension. So it does not patch anything there. So I think you can answer this with yes.
You need your command line. I think the best thing is to install Semantic MediaWiki, really, is do it via command line and so on. And with Composer, doing other things is a voodoo, which is really, I wouldn't go for it, actually. Yeah. In the end, I think already for MediaWiki, to make it worthwhile and easy maintainable, you need to have command line, just to be frank here. I think it's just... shared hosting is a dream which foreclosed in the meantime, I think, in a way. But it's still possible, but it's really a hassle. Yeah? It costs more time than it brings anything to you. Yeah.